Good afternoon. I'm Keith Padilla, Chairman of the Safety Committee of the Sherryland ISD Board of Trustees. On March 16, 2020, Governor Greg Abbott granted a request by Texas Attorney General Ken Paxton to temporarily suspend a limited number of open meeting laws to the extent necessary to allow telephonic or video conference meetings in response to the coronavirus. In accordance with those suspended rules, notice of this meeting of this committee has been posted online for at least 72 hours. Although members of the committee are not gathered in a central physical location, we do have a quorum of committee members in attendance at this meeting by video conference and or telephone call. The committee is meeting by the use of Google Hangout and telephone transmission, which allows two-way communication for members of the public during public comments. This meeting is being recorded and will be made available to the public in accordance with the law. As we would at any in-person committee meeting, members of the public who have followed the instructions on the meeting notice for registering to speak during the public comment portion of the agenda will be called at the telephone number they have provided to speak for up to 5 minutes. All other meeting procedures will adhere to board-adopted procedures to the extent practicable. We apologize in advance for any unforeseeable technical difficulties and ask for your patience as we navigate these unprecedented conditions. The time is now 12:33 p.m. and I'll call this meeting of the Safety Committee to order. Let the record show, I guess we don't really need a quorum, right? Committee members that are present, Dr. Noy Oliveira and Julio, are you on?
Yes.
Okay, Mr. Julio Cerda and myself, Keith Padilla. And I don't believe there are any other members of the Board of Trustees, right?
No, sir.
Okay, so then we could move to, I guess, let me do a roll call. Dr. Noy Oliveira?
Here.
Julio Cerda?
Present.
Okay, any public comments?
No, sir.
Okay, item four, safety. A, discuss safety and security plan at Sherryland ISD. Smiley, is that you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I don't know if Dr. B wanted a preface or are we good?
No, we can go ahead and get started.
Okay. So, of course,
really quick,
it's in relation. Yes, sir.
Just a reminder for everyone to mute their mic when they're not speaking.
10-4, David. Thank you. This is in relation to an item that we had discussion on at the budget board workshop this last Monday. Mark did present a presentation briefly, and that's something that we wanted to talk about today regarding our security services strategic plan moving to the 2020-2021 school year. So I'm going to pretty much hand it off to Mark so that he can go through what we've laid out and foresee for 2021 and pretty much open it up for a discussion regarding the direction this safety committee wants to recommend to our entire board of trustees as we move forward into this upcoming school year. You wanna go ahead, Mark?
Yes, sir, thank you. Mr. Padilla, Dr. Vidaldi, other board members, thank you for giving me the opportunity today. So I just wanna go through, we had been working on security, our security plan at the district, went on almost 2 years now. We've brought different things that we've done throughout the district to help solidify our security within our district. This plan that we're bringing to, we're kind of narrowing it down, and it's in regards to some conversations we've had regarding armed security. If you all recall, this past school year, at all our elementary campuses, we put a security guard. Albeit non-armed, a security guard at each campus. We hadn't done that before. So what we're talking about now, or what we've talked about leading to this now is, do we move forward? There was a plan introduced on moving forward with armed peace officers. So the objective today is if we want to move forward with armed peace officers, we will need to get some approval from the board. Starting from the safety committee, then taking it to the board for next Monday's meeting because one of the things that we have to get with the agencies is signed MOUs. And the agencies that we're talking about is Mission Police Department, Alton Police Department, and Constable Office Larry Gallardo. David, can you go to the next slide, please? So just give everybody a brief outline of what we currently have in our campuses in regards to police departments and security guards. At security guards, we have a total of 8, and that is for one security guard at each of our 8 elementaries. At our junior highs, we have 2 police officers, or one, I should say, one police officer at each campus, as well as 2 security guards. That's where you get the numbers 2 and 4. The high schools, we have 2 police officers, and we have 5 security guards, and this is during the school day. And then at our SAEC campus, we have 3 security guards. And this is our security profile during the school day. And this is primarily what we are discussing here and in this presentation. Questions? Not David, let's go to the next slide, please. So strategic plan consensus from the following committees to recommend proposal. So we've taken this to the safety committee, BOF committee, we've had conversations with the superintendent, executive committee. We presented a plan March workshop. Apologize for that. I don't know where that one, that should have been changed. But at the March workshop, we did present a plan. We have, with this coming budget, we have added the police officers the armed police officers into the budget right now. It is embedded in the budget in draft one, and the cost for that is approximately $300,000. David, you want to go to the next slide? Some of the solutions that we've looked at in the past was to add 2 mission police officers to patrol the elementary campuses. This would be at an additional cost. Officers would be dedicated to patrol the elementary campuses during the day. Chief Dominguez from Mission has said, hey, he's more than happy to help us with this, but he did mention that there could be some hurdles to overcome because we've got 4 of our campuses that are in the McAllen city jurisdiction, as well as we have 1 in Alton. But he would definitely work with us if this is the route we wanted to go to. One of the other solutions we had was to take our current security guards, the 8 security guards that we had at the elementary campuses, and arm them. We have a preliminary cost or a budgeted cost at the time that we did this presentation was $28,000. Cost maybe just a little bit higher. I think we're looking in $32,000. So what this would do is this would take our 8 security guards and make them from non-armed to armed officers. Everything else would stay the same.
Let me just chime in there, and Dr. O, I'm sure you probably will, and Julio, feel free. But so so for an additional 28 on top of what we're paying now, we could get those security guards armed, licensed, test background checks. That would encumber all of the requirements that I guess the state requires, or yes, the school, sir. Or
yes, sir. That cost would be a little bit more. We went back and we looked at something. So the cost would be not significantly much more. It'd probably be closer to $32,000-$33,000.
Okay.
So you know, but
okay. Yeah, no, that's insignificant.
So yes, sir. They would be what's considered level 4 security guards. They would have testing background, everything that the state mandates in order for them to be armed security officers. They would have all the training.
I would assume these would probably be maybe Mondo's top guys, or guys that have been with him for a while, or
yes, sir.
You know, ones that he trusts himself, and you know, things like that. Is that correct?
Yeah. Yes, sir. That would, and he would. I mean, I'm sure you all know, and I'm sure I know Dr. V can attest. Mondo's very involved. I mean, he's like, I'd be, you know, even more involved, which I don't know how much more he could be because he's very involved. But you know, if we went that route, you know, he would. You know, he said he'd be even more involved if that's the route we wanted to go.
Okay. Julio or Dr. O, you got anything? No?
Dr. O.
Oh. He may have stepped out.
Yeah, I'm on here. It's okay. Just right in the middle of something here. Let me skip right now, and then I'll get right on here in about 5 minutes.
Okay. We can get back to that if you want, unless you have something to add, Julio, on there.
No, I had the same question that you had as far as the armed guards. I'm pretty sure that Mando's got them, certified. Plus, he's a certified instructor.
Yes, sir.
For the, what do they call it? Your license, the carry, license to carry, I guess.
Yeah, concealed license instructor.
Concealed license instructor, that's correct. And I'm pretty sure that he follows everything down to the T, and I've seen Mando at every game, you know, being Sherry or Pioneer. And he shows up at basically all events that we have, which is uncommon to see from owners like that to be themselves out there. And of course, Mando being an ex-police officer helps tremendously. So,
okay. Well, sorry, I think y'all have seen him at the games, but he's still a constable. He's still a constable. He still practices because he needs it to keep his license. Current, but he's a deputy constable, I should say. He's not a constable, he's a deputy constable.
Yeah, Julio, I agree with you. He is very visible. You see him at everything. And just for the record, I stayed in the meeting. I just needed to get something done here at the office. But, yeah, I agree with you, Julio. He's very visible. I see him at all the games, all the events, and his staff. And so far, I haven't had any problems with him at all.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mark.
Yes, ma'am.
And Mr. Badia, if I may interject too, just thinking about the options we might have here at the end. The other thing coming, like in January, February, I remember we had an incident at PHS. So one of the things that has come up also is in talking to Mando is an opportunity maybe for him to, he has a vested interest in us and, to be able to carry and for him to be able to come in and support. And I don't know if he visited with you about that, Mark, but then all of this happened. We left for spring break and I was intending to bring this up for maybe towards the end of the year or for the fall, but somehow including him in that. So in other words, something happens, he could be a first responder out there as well and be armed. Right now he's careful of not being armed. And I think that would probably just need an MOU from us, or we would get with Ivan and legal and what would be needed for him to act in that capacity for our district as well. So I know that's come up. I know we're speaking about Mondo, but to me, when that came up to me, it was just like another added safety feature that we could look at with legal and see how that would work with him. As well.
Yes, ma'am. We definitely did have that conversation and it's something that, he does bring to the table. He definitely brings that to the table.
And just to take that a little bit further on what you talked about, Dr. Villas, I've mentioned before going to these meetings, these school board meetings, a lot of these districts, now have, liaisons, like they're employed by the district and their job is to, not only make sure that the security guards and admin at the different campuses are prepared and know what the latest and greatest things now are on safety and what to look out for now in kids' mental and physical makeup and things like that. And my little dream would be to have somebody like that is in touch with the admin, that's in touch with the security officers, that's in touch with the mission PD that are out there, that coordinates, drills, that, comes up with plans in case, certain things happen, that goes to the conferences and gets up to date on all the specific security and safety rules that are coming out by Texas and the U.S. And, you know, I don't know if you guys would even be interested in considering something like that. I know it'd probably be a little bit additional to arming the security guards, but I mean, I think even though we don't know what money's going to be like in the next year or two, you know, not adding the police officers at every campus, I'd still, just in my opinion, still feel we need to add any kind of level of security that we can at the schools. And, you know, whether or not we think they're going to go back or not, I still think in the long run for the school district that it would be advantageous to add that extra layer of security and maybe having somebody like that.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
I noticed that Mark was writing down what he's going to add to his resume.
Wait, am I filling my resume? Where am I going? I'm not going anywhere.
Wow, Julio.
I hope not.
No, I just thought he was adding to his job description just one more item.
What were you going to say, Dr.
Mr. Padilla, yes. Mr. Chairman, we have, you know, we discussed this over the past year before, and then, of course, it's been ongoing that we want anybody armed to also be from one of the police departments or one of the armed, departments around us, including local PD, sheriff's office, DPS, and certainly constable would fit that, because we wanted them to undergo specific training from that entity right. in which they are licensed
right.
to carry. And so, he would fit that mold because he has to be qualified to carry through his constable department, which I guess is under the sheriff's department. And again, that would be awesome to have, you know, another armed personnel on for Sherryland.
Well, go ahead, Julio.
Adding to that, and I like that idea, is a retired officer, from either Mission or McAllen. And I guess what we're leading to is to a person that basically has the background, you know, 20, 25, 30 years of experience. That's going to be basically directing and overseeing Mondo, but an actual armed guy that has the experience and has had, all the certifications that we need to make sure that they take care of our kids. That person would be basically reporting to either Mark or directly to the superintendent and just giving us more ideas as we go along. Because, you know, from our standpoint, from the committee standpoint, of course, we just see what the guys are giving us as far as recommendations. But I think somebody that's, you know, driving around and looking at our schools on a daily or weekly basis, that would help.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, and I'm not, you know, trying to say one person or the other, but someone like Mondo that not only has all those, you know, training and certifications and years of experience, but he's also already got the passion and for Sherryland, and he's here, and this is where his heart is. And I think that someone like that, you know, just adds to, you know, as opposed to bringing somebody in from, you know, Mission that hasn't been tied to Sherryland or McAllen, not to say that they couldn't do that, but I think he may add that little element of, you know, heart and passion that we're looking for. So anyway, that's just some discussion and some things that I wanted to bring up.
May I interject just real quick on that subject, Mr. Padilla?
Sure, of course.
I think it would be simple to just maybe amend our security contract, depending on how we decide to go here at the end. But we could amend that security contract. We could then include some of those responsibilities from Mando, because he's the one that carries that. And then this would give him the abilities that should something happen at our schools, should we be, God forbid, but should something happen, he's able to react. He's able to then command, connect, and be armed. He does that. He does come, and he is part of that team. I know in a couple of incidents he's been there, but he's not been armed. And so he's there in support, but he hasn't been able to be there in that capacity. So I think we're looking, if I'm hearing this right, and what I was looking at last semester was that, is trying to get him in that ability to react and then to be in that capacity.
Yeah.
Give him that opportunity.
And I think that, and maybe that's the same lines as, you know, him, you know, walking, you know, routinely walking the schools, walking the campuses, you know, the admin on the campus know who he is, who, and the teachers know, the kids know, you know, I think just something like that added to the contract may be a simple solution for that.
Mr. Chairman, this is Oliveira. He also is a firearms instructor. He has the instructor license to train and get people certified and licensed to carry. I'm not sure if he's a firearms instructor with Sheriff's Department or with you know, the constables group, but we can find that out too. But he is a licensed instructor with the state of Texas DPS to teach people and train them to get their license to carry.
Okay. Thanks, Dr. O. That's great information.
I know, Mr. Gonzalez, we had talked. Can you interject, Mr. Gonzalez, on some of the things that we also had talked about?
You know, that I mean, it's pretty much aligned with what, you know, Mr. Padilla is mentioning. It's a matter of just amending the current contract and expectations that we have for our security plan in place, utilizing these solutions, implementing them just as any change order would be on a contracted a service that we received currently. So, you know, from providing those trainings and drills and everything that you all are mentioning, you know, having that training in firearm or whatever the case may be, talking to students, whatever you need, Dr. Vidaudi, from this person, if it is Mondo or MLG, really, it's MLG who is the vendor, asking them to be able, if they could provide those services, and then pretty much giving us a quote or a proposal of how much more it's going to cost, and taking that back to the board and moving forward with it shouldn't be an issue upcoming next month, because if I stand corrected, Mark, we would be bringing that annual renewal of MLG to the board next month, correct?
Yes, sir.
Three-year contract?
Three-year contract
with an annual renewal.
And we're in year one, so we would still have the option to renew for two additional years if the board so chooses.
If I may just add for the record, you know, just, you know, the reason why I guess we're here having and revisiting it's because of these unprecedented times. You know, it's obvious. That's the elephant in the room. And I think it's a matter of the discussion that we've had at the board workshop is, number one, the reoccurring cost of bringing peace officers right now, the uncertainties that we've received from not only the Texas Education Agency, but also our Texas Comptroller, Glenn Hager, on possible biennium cuts. And at the same time, receiving positive information from our safety auditor that Mark works with on a three-year basis, where, you know, they gave that positive feedback saying that they were happy with what Mark has been able to do and our team securing our buildings and ensuring, you know, the safety for our students and our staff. So I think it's just today. Yeah, I wanted to bring that up as far as just the unprecedented times and the uncertainty when it comes to the budget moving forward in the upcoming biennium, when it comes to, you know, understanding the states dealing with oil price drops and sales tax revenue deficits. They're rising, and we that are in public education need to be prepared for that, because what we're hearing is a possible 2011 biennium cut. So,
hey,
thank you,
Mr. Chairman. I know that the elephant's been getting bigger and bigger. It used to be 800 pounds, now it's about 950. And one concern that I have being the safety committee is that over the summer, typically we have minimal security throughout the campuses. Am I correct, Mark?
Yes, sir. Over the summer, we typically have campus at our security at both high schools 24/7. We have, if I'm correct, two patrols during the day, one patrolling north, one patrolling south, and then we do the same thing at night, patrol north, patrol south.
Okay, and with that, okay.
No, sorry about that. I misspoke. We only have it at night because during the day we're there working, so then we have the night patrols, one patrolling north, one patrolling south, and they patrol all our campuses.
Okay, with that, and Dr. Noel Scheinman, because you know a little bit more about this than I do, but with that, with the craziness that's going out there right now, and you know, the 900-pound gorilla that's out there, people are going to tend to be looking for easy money, you know, and the last thing that we want is for people to be getting into our elementaries, into our administration, into our high schools, just for the sake of making a little bit of money. So we if we can spend a couple minutes on that, just so that we can see what we can do to keep the building safe.
So Mr. Sevda, if I may add, so right now what we've done since we've gone into the COVID situation, for the lack of a better term, we've got night security at every campus, every night, 7 days a week, plus our bus barn facility. So we so during the nighttime hours, I want to say it's from 11 to 7 in the morning, we have a security guard at every facility, and then during the day we have patrol. So again, during the day we will always have a guard at every one of our high school, at both high schools. There's always a guard there. We have a guard patrolling throughout the day and in the evenings, and then at night we have overnight at every campus. Because of that, we've got roughly $200 million in property throughout the district. So the idea was we put the guard on, and we did that as soon as we went into this COVID situation because of that thinking, Mr. Sevda. So we've been doing that.
Very good.
And then just, unless anybody has anything else, just real quick, back on this.
Could I add on? I did have one thing to share on the surveillance cameras that might add to this as well. Yes, we do have over 400 surveillance cameras district-wide with three staff members that are monitoring all those cameras, and they work in conjunction with security, administrators, police officers. If it helps to talk about the entire, you know, security, you know, that we have. So it does help.
No, definitely. That's the best deterrent we have right there. I appreciate you bringing that up because, I mean, that is very, very important. Thank you. And I think with this person, you know, whoever, you know, I think that person could help with investigations, you know, kind of be a liaison to Dr. V or whoever, you know, and giving her information on that. And so, and then Julio or maybe Smiley, this talking about potential cuts and in the not knowing, you know, maybe we don't do a 3-year contract. Maybe we just consider doing a 1-year contract. You know, I don't know what that would do, you know, and for the only reason, because we're not sure what's going to happen in the future. And, you know, it's not because we're not going to like or trust somebody, but just kind of gives us an out should we have to make some changes to that. Any thoughts on that?
Mr. Padilla, if I may answer that, it's a 1-year contract. Every year it's a 1-year contract. We just have the option, or the board has the option, the district has the option to renew for two additional ones. So
okay, every year it's a 1-year then.
Yes, sir. It's a 1-year thing. It's just the way that the proposal went out, it was for 1 year with the option to renew for 2 more years.
Okay, gotcha.
Yes, sir. Based on the design that is placed in this contracted request, as far as services goes, we have the flexibility of making those amendments if need be. And I think it's a matter of amending the contract based on the vendor that we hire. So in the case that in 2 years down the road or next year we decide to move on and re-procure security services based on our plan and the plan that Dr. Vidaudi puts in place, it would be a matter of that company being able to provide those additional services that we look at requesting. Okay. Not necessarily an individual. If that's the case, sure. Then it would be a matter of opening up a position and hiring a new employee for the district. But
we whatever you think is going to be easier and flow easier, I think that's, you know, we'll go with you on that.
Okay. And I'm assuming, Dr. V, that's the approach, right? Okay, perfect. I think you had another slide, Mark, on this one. You're on mute.
Sorry. I had another slide. Yes. So this is what we've talked about in regards to cost. So if we were to add a peace officer to every campus, we are looking at additional cost of $420,000. Okay. So, David, if you go to the next slide, there are some opportunities for savings where we could lower that. I guess the only one that I feel would be feasible is if we did add the police officers to the elementary campuses, that we would cut out the security guard. That would be a savings of $120,000. So you would still add $300,000 to the budget. You know, from what I'm gathering from the committee, it's steering more towards, let's just go with arming the security guards from what we've had our conversations, correct? Or am I jumping ahead?
Yes.
Well, I think that's the biggest question from the board workshop and hearing the different ideas from different board members and the direction. That's what we need to decide if what we want to recommend on Monday, whether we go with the security guards, arming them, which would be that cost that Mark has shared, or if we want to go with the original plan was going with police departments and the other municipalities for the other campuses, which was going to be about 300 and some thousand, correct, Mark?
Yeah, if we went just with the security guards and arming them, then the savings would be $210,000, $260 approximately. You wouldn't have that $300,000 hit. Is that the question you asked? I'm sorry, my mind went blank for a second.
Yeah, it's a minor addition to the budget. And I think that the concern is what we're heading into, the times we may be heading into. We have that idea to keep in mind, but the also keeping in mind that we also want to secure our campuses. And we had securities for the spring semester, security guards, those worked out great. They were excellent. No complaints throughout the whole, you know, first 3 months that we did have them out there. So I'm hearing that if we just did the arming of them, either arming them and we pay that little extra, or we don't arm them and we keep just our security guards as we did this spring. I mean, those are kind of the options we have.
Yeah.
And add some added duties to Mondo. So we have that other layer of an armed person that is able to react should anything happen. So those are some options.
Yeah, those are good points. Because we got to remember that before all this started, this COVID stuff, we had craziness already. You know, we already had issues and we can't just look past those because of this COVID that's taken over. So, but I think you're right, Mimi. I think those are the options that we would be looking at. And would you agree, Julio and Dr. O?
Yes, I'm with you. And okay. I believe that we did discuss one more thing last time, and that was one additional guard for SA3. Now, I know that but now is the time to consider it. Additional to what Mimi was talking about, additional to talking to Mondo about being an armed guard and being a little bit more, more active in our area. He's already active enough, but additional to what Mimi was talking about, I think one additional security guard to SA3 in particular. What are your thoughts?
Mark, I don't remember. I'm sorry. Do you have the slide on?
I don't have that slide.
Because really those all work in conjunction with SHS. So we included the extra on that. But this is
additional. We briefly discussed it while we're discussing about arming every single elementary, and then we did discuss on that one security guard, possible security guard addition to the SA3. But if that's not the case, that's fine with me. I mean, I'm just throwing it out there.
Okay.
I just want to add, I think it's based on looking and talking with Mondo based on ratio, Mark. Maybe we can connect with him and just really look at, is every area in our camp at our campuses, if we're going to continue with this current plan, secured? You know, is there a need for somebody out there? And if it's justified and we do have that need, then maybe we can share that with Dr. Vidaudi. I don't know how you feel about that, Dr. V, as we amend this contract. I mean, that's making minimal adjustments to it. If we're planning on just redesigning the current expectations from our third party administrator regarding security services. If that's the case, then it's a matter of just getting that assessment completed, right?
Yes.
Okay. I don't know if that answers the concern, Mr. Cerda.
Yes. Okay. Basically sitting down with Mondo, that would basically bring things down.
And again, this is Oli Beta, if I may add, and it's been mentioned already before in this meeting and probably every meeting we've had since the problem with COVID-19 started. And in my opinion, and this is just personal opinion, though it is, of course, medical related, I don't think we're anywhere near the peak of this, especially if we start opening things up again. With how fast this virus infects people, and it's a lot different than the flu in that aspect, and then we've seen it, you know, actually kill more people. So I just don't think we're there, and whether we are or not, my point is nobody really knows where we're going to stand budgetary wise, and just attending school, virtual, all the other things that are going on. So this will have to be placed in some kind of, you know, priority lineup along with everything else, you know, instruction, everything else we spend money on. And then, you know, that'll give us a little more direction as to how far we can go as far as, you know, from a budget and hiring and, you know, all the things we've discussed already. I just wanted to interject that.
Thank you, Doc. Makes a lot of sense.
Yep.
So as far as this, Dr. V, it's a matter of going to the board on Monday and just letting them know as an informational that, or are we, does there still have to be action taken on this, or does this solidify the final decision? I guess, do we have to go take action on moving forward with our current security plan and amending it and bringing it back next month? Or, and I'm just saying, just because we have to post by 5, just so that right. We can have it clear.
And I think what I'm hearing is that we stick with our security system that we have right now, the 8, and maybe making that recommendation to arm them, which is going to be minimal to the other plan that we had. And we can always revisit that later once things secure a little bit. But I do agree with Dr. No, and I think safety is our priority. I don't worry about during the day, you know, David, all the stuff that they do, our cameras, you know, we've, you know, we can call, we can take care of business like that, but the one-to-one, the people coming up, you know, safety's, you know, you can't put a price tag on that really.
Exactly.
So I'd hate not to do it. I think it's up there in our priority as well. It was already in the budget, Smiley. It would be minimal. Mm-hmm. So hearing the board, seeing the numbers, understanding where we're at curriculum-wise, what we're planning for opening up school, not the uncertainties, and I think we're okay in those areas of what we plan to do there. And I think I would be recommending what we've talked about just now, arming our security, keeping them there. It's a minimal cost. We get with Mondo, we add that next layer of security that will help. And then we hold off on trying to do like all the other municipalities that we had originally planned.
Yeah. And I think they'll understand. And I agree with that 100%. You know, we were looking at 380,000 or 300,000. You know, we can't, let's be a little more conservative now, but at the same time, add some layers. So I think it's kind of the best of both worlds as an option. So I agree with you, Dr. Vialdi.
I also agree with Dr. V. Also, Mr. Chairman, knowing that we might have an election for the board president coming up next month, and hopefully you get all the votes, including Dr. No, that's on the other side. Hopefully I can continue on this safety committee after May. And I would like to also see if maybe we can get together our next meeting sometime in August, maybe have a safety meeting to include Mondo in the safety meeting also.
Yeah, no doubt. I think you know, once we move forward and we get a consensus from the board on what we're going to do, then by all means, you know, let's get on top of it and stay on top of it and you know, come up with the plan. And as you guys are continuing to do, Mark, appreciate it, but just maybe come up with a more consistent pattern to, you know, make sure that we're on top of things. So just like you're doing now. So
no, yes, sir, we can do that. And just if I may reiterate, just before we went, before COVID, and literally it was a week before spring break, we had this year, I'm sure y'all are aware, we're in the third year cycle of our state mandated Texas safety audits. We had a company out of Marble Falls. Oh my God, it slipped my mind. But they do at least half the districts in the whole state of Texas. They do their safety audits. When they came, they did ours. I'm very happy and proud to say they're very complimentary. They said we're probably one of the few districts that really have our act together that they've done in the state. You know, they're very, you know, good about saying, or they stress to us, you know, getting onto your campuses when school starts is very, very difficult. You know, they tried getting the elementary campuses, all the doors were locked, you know, you got to get buzzed in. They were questioned. Staff does, you know, for the most part, does a really good job of, hey, why are you walking around? You don't have a badge or anything. So, you know, the safety, it's not just security. It's all these things that we have that we're ingraining into our staff. Of course, there's always room for improvement, and they're going to give us a report, and we're going to share that report with all the board and let them know, you know, here's, you know, or definitely here's what we do good and here's what we can do better. But I feel a lot better, you know, I felt a lot better after that, knowing that, you know, we've done a lot and we still have a way to go. But we actually, you know, it's something that we don't just talk about. We actually follow up and we practice what we say. And it was good to have somebody else from the outside. It was Edward Risk Management. They came from the outside and they came and they told us that. So it made, you know, I think it helps let us know that what we're doing is we're doing the right thing, and we just got to keep going that route.
And I'm glad you brought up the technology department and David, because I know a lot of those guys, and just they're passionate about what they do, and we appreciate their passion and their knowledge, you know, and you know, that's the first line right there. And and the way you guys continue to work together, that just makes that makes it a lot easier. Just working as a team makes things a lot easier. So, Dave, appreciate you guys and your group, and then of course Mark and your guidance and everything you guys continue to do. So
thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I've got one more slide. It's a little bit, it still talks about our safety plan, but this is more of, you know, governor's already starting to loosen some things up. He said, hey, if teachers want to go back, they can go back to clean classrooms and all that. So we're also trying to be forward thinking. You know, if the event we get back to school, we get employees coming in. Just want to let, you know, update you all some of the things that we are doing. Dr. Oliveira, if you have, I welcome any other suggestions. And that doesn't necessarily have to be today, but if something you see out there, please, you know, let us know. But just some of the things that we're going to start doing, because again, COVID's going to change the way we do everything from here on out. We're going to work, and we've already ordered, and they should be coming in. We're going to be hand sanitizing dispensers at all entrances of our campuses. Okay, so when the public walks in, anybody walks in, we're always going to, you know, we're going to get to the point where, you know, hey, sanitize your hands, please. Of course, masks are going to be there, but I believe you all may have seen the video of the backpack sprayers that we saw. We're ordering more because I want to get to a point, especially if, you know, God willing and everything, we do happen to start school in August. We're going to have backpack sprayers so at the end of every day, we can sanitize every campus. Every day.
That would be awesome.
That's something that's just going to become part of our daily routine.
Yeah.
So as the kids leave, end of the day, teachers, everybody, we're sanitizing every building. So the next morning, we give people, you know, a little bit of assurance that we're doing everything we can. We're going to order more masks for our
Mark,
staff.
Mr. Doherty, I don't mean to interrupt you. I'm going to have to step off, but I like that. That's a great plan. Just a question. Are they going to be the manual hand sanitizers where they have to pump on the handle, or is it going to be that one that automatically, let me preface by saying the automatic one, I'm quite sure is more expensive and also requires probably more maintenance and, you know, to fix them when they break. However, they do dispense a smaller amount, and that's all you really need. I teach my staff, you only need one pump, and I hear people go to the wash rack or those things and pump them like five times, and I'm like, are you gonna bathe in that today? And you know, one pump, and I show them, lathers your hands with soap, turning the water on to full, they wet their hands and they leave it running on full for the 20-25 seconds, and I teach them how to not do that. So my point is, if we use the ones that automatically dispense a certain amount, we might make our money back in the fact that we're not going to be going through container after container after container, refilling all those dispensers when they would last a lot longer if that just that one small amount is dispensed each time.
Well, we can definitely look into that.
Okay, thank you. I know it seems like, you know, that's kind of piddly, but the other thing it does is if you didn't have bacteria on your hands to begin with, when you touch that dispenser, I can guarantee you, you now have everybody's palm of their hand, whatever they had on it, including some really decrepit, contaminants on their hands. Now you have a chance of getting those on your hand because you had to touch a dispenser when you never had them before. So just another point.
No, good point. We'll definitely look into that.
Okay, and then, with that, Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry, but I'm going to have to step out. I have a, business to take care of here.
Thank you, Doc. We appreciate you, and be safe out there.
And I wanted to reiterate too what you guys have already said. Thank you to all the administration and Mark, great presentation. Dave, man, all the time. IT, Smiley, thanks. Dr. B, Dr. G, thank you so much. And everybody else, I don't know who else is in the room. And hey, thanks, Mayor. Committee. Hey, there you go. Thank you. Okay, so have a great rest of the day, and we'll see y'all later.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doc.
Stay safe.
And then just to add one more thing, we're already looking at getting plexiglass on all our open, you know, when you go into campuses, especially the elementaries, you walk in there, you've got an employee that's sitting at a desk, it's open. Well, we're going to, you know, take the ideas of what HEB and all the supermarkets are doing. We're going to be doing that to protect our staff, right? Because, you know, we don't know how long this is going to be with us. So these are just some things. The other thing I want to stress too is working with the nurse, and that we're definitely working with the nurses with this. And one thing that we didn't get this added, and it was done late last night, literally, or early this morning. David helped out a lot in his technology, and this is where we're using technology is going to help us. One of the concerns the nurses had was bathroom passes, right? So especially at the elementaries, it's the same bathroom pass that's hanging. Kids grab it and go. David's working with the nurse and creating a virtual bathroom pass that you can do via technology. So that's one less touch point for all the kids and everything. So the nurses are definitely, are coming up with some great ideas, and we are sitting with them, it's a plan that it's a group. Dr. Gorena, we're all working on this together. I could never take all the credit because it's, there are a lot of more people smarter than me working on this that are helping.
That's funny, Mark. You usually tell me that everything is based on your ideas,
and we put this on just so we want to give you all some assurances that we are already thinking 3 months down the road what could happen, and we're planning for it now, because some of this stuff that you want to buy, you've got to buy now because there's a line already for it. And so we've already done a lot of these things. Gloves, we didn't put gloves in there, but all these things that they're recommending, and then we're definitely looking at all the changes that the CDC is asking for, and we're keeping and monitoring that closely, so we make sure that we have those things. So
okay. Dr. V,
thank you for all your ideas, Mark.
Julio?
Thank you for all your ideas, Mark.
They're not all mine.
Just for clarification and for the record, the company is Edwards Risk Management.
Yes, Edwards Risk Management. Yep.
Okay. Hey, Dr. V, did you want to add anything?
Excited. I think we can you hear me? I'm excited. I think we have a good plan. We're keeping with the vision of securing our campus and security across the board. Mark's already looking at, safety, health also. We've been talking and meeting about different things that we can do for next year. And again, COVID has changed. I sit here and I think I hadn't even thought about that, but now I'm thinking about all those darn little passes, and I'm sure the kids never washed their hands, and I never thought about that before. So really, we all think differently now. And the more we can do, the more we learn as we go. But I think we've got some really good ideas here on how to continue with the vision of security at Sherrilyn ISD, which is also important. So I'm good. I think this is a good plan. Very good.
Julio, you have anything to add?
Oh, that hall pass was very good idea, Mark. remember that sheriff deputy that we brought in and he did a security check also, Mark?
Garcia, Sergeant Garcia.
Yeah.
Sergeant Garcia.
Yeah, we also checked with him during the year, right? We did that a couple times.
Yes, we've been following his recommendations. We put those, if you saw the pillars in front of John H. Sherry Elementary. So yes, sir, we've definitely done those things as well.
Okay. So we have basically two different groups, one being Sergeant Garcia and the other group from up north.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, congratulations. Thank you very much, guys. I really appreciate it. I got to go work so I can pay for my insurance bill. So with that, Mr. Chairman, I really need to step down. I'd like to just say thank you to staff and thank you, Mimi, for all the hard work that you do. And hopefully the new board president that's coming up points me again to the safety committee.
We'll see. I'm going to have discussions with Mark to see what he thinks.
I'm not involved in that one. Don't get me involved.
That's not what you said last time.
Julio's such a politician. Good job, Julio.
Thanks, Julio. Now get to
You're
work.
Welcome, guys. Take care.
We're good.
Okay, guys.
All right.
Thank you guys for everything.
Got it. Thank you, sir.
Again.
You too. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Padilla.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Good seeing you all. Bye.
Bye-bye.